Our scripture reading today is from the book of Philippians. Just a letter from Paul to thank the Philippians for the gift they had sent Paul and to strengthen those believers by showing them that true joy comes from Jesus Christ alone. I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at last you have revived your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned for me but had no opportunity to show it. Not that I am referring to being in need, for I have learned to be content with whatever I have. I know what it is to have little, and I know what it is to have plenty. In any and all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being well fed and of going hungry, of having plenty and of being in need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. In any case, it was kind of you to share my distress. You Philippians indeed know that in the early days of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, no church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving, except you alone. For even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me help for my needs more than once. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the profit that accumulates to your account. I have been paid in full and have more than enough. I am fully satisfied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. And my God will fully satisfy every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Will you please be in the spirit? Gracious and loving God, help us now as we think about Paul's words. Help us to apply them in our own lives, that we too may each learn the secret of being content in all circumstances. Help us to think and listen with clear minds and open hearts. May each one of us receive the word you have prepared for us this day. May the words of my mouth be pleasing and acceptable to you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Dr. Fred Craddock tells of growing up during the Great Depression. Some people here may be able to resonate with this story. Of course, you know, it was the Great Depression and times were hard. His family often didn't have enough money or struggled with where they would find the money to make their ends meet. They had to move from the country into the city, and every able-bodied member of the family then had to go and find a job and do some work. And they kept a cigar box on the kitchen table, and when they each got paid, they would come home and put all the money in the cigar box so that mom would have enough money to buy the groceries, pay the rent and the bills, and keep them going. But every once in a while, on a Friday, Dad would take a little money out of the cigar box and go into town and get a box of chocolate or a pretty red rose for mom. And of course, she would always fuss and carry on about how they couldn't afford that. We don't have enough money as it is, and we go spending it on frou-frou and stuff, you know. And so one day, Fred's father said something that has stuck with Fred ever since. He said he never forgot it. His father said to Mrs. Craddock, "When our lives are defined by what goes in and out of the box, we will then be poor people. Life will have then robbed us of our joy." Now Jesus said in John chapter 16, in this world you will have problems, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. So when Jesus said this, he didn't say you simply have to hang on and endure the problems. He said, be of good cheer. So we need to get his whole message, not just half the message. Half the message is that we will have problems. Does anybody here not have any problems? I'd like to come stand next to you and see if some of that magic can rub off on me, you know? Yeah, we will have problems, but the whole message is that we can still be of good cheer because Christ is our overcomer. Scott Peck opens his wonderful best-selling book, The Road Less Traveled, with a similar statement. First sentence in the book is, life is difficult. And then he continues, this is a great truth, one of the greatest truths. It is a great truth because once we truly see this truth, then we can transcend it. Imagine a man who will conduct 40 to 50 funerals a day, burying nearly 4,500 people in all. And among those dying would be his own wife. And towards the end, the deaths would be so frequent that the bodies would just be placed in trenches without any burial rites. Now imagine also that this person would be so thankful for these experiences that he'd write a hymn that would be sung by Christians late 300 years later on another continent. A fantasy? Well, not if you're describing Martin Rinkhardt, a Lutheran pastor of Germany during the 30 Years' War. And he lived in a walled city, and so the city was filled with refugees because of the walls. They came there for safety during the war. And because of the crowding, this overcrowding of thousands of refugees brought on epidemic and famine. And all of the town officials and all the other pastors in town left, leaving only poor Martin Rinkhardt to care for the dying. The hymn that he composed, we sing every year. Now thank we all our God with hearts and hands and voices. For you see, gratitude does not depend on the circumstances. Now imagine, if you will, another man, one who would be wiped out financially. Let's say that he's a farmer, and one year there's just too much rain, everything is covered with water. Let's also specify that when the dry land appears and dries a bit, he'll offer 1/7 of his remaining assets as a thanksgiving to God. Is that incredible? Not if you're describing Noah. For you see, gratitude does not depend on the circumstances. Or invent an army general whose lines of supply would fall apart. Let's say that his men will be starving. Their uniforms are ragged. Their shoes are bottomless. And when the ordeal is over, he'll issue a proclamation of thanksgiving. A fairy tale? Well, not if you're describing George Washington, the father of our country. Gratitude does not depend on the circumstances. Or create a character who will have no family and no home, and he'll be afflicted with a loathsome disease, perhaps one that causes matter to ooze from the eyes, making people turn away and not want to look at it. And decorate his body with scars all over from rods and whips and stones. And let's say that in nearly every letter he writes, even when he's in jail unjustly, he thanks God for the privilege of suffering for him. Is that unreal? Now that we're speaking of the Apostle Paul, for gratitude does not depend on the circumstances. In our lesson this morning, Paul writes to the Philippians from a prison cell. He says, I have learned to be content with whatever I have. I know what it is to have little, and I know what it is to have plenty. In any and all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being well fed and of going hungry, of having plenty and of being in need. I can do all things through Him who strengthens me. And you don't have to take Paul's words alone to believe that he knew the secret of joy. Others also wrote about this. You know, Luke, who wrote the Gospel according to Luke, also wrote the book of Acts. And he recognized this about Paul. He wrote, if you will recall, in Acts 16, how Paul and Silas were thrown into prison for preaching the gospel. What did they do while they were sitting there in the stocks in the dungeon? You remember? They sang. They sang hymns of praise to God. Here they are in the darkest part of the dungeon, in the stocks, their backs bloodied by the flogging, and the guards and the prisoners at midnight heard them singing. They must have been thinking, these guys, who are these guys? They are nuts. They're in prison and they're singing. And then an earthquake shakes the place, and the guard is about to take his own life because he's sure that they're going to grab this opportunity to escape. And Paul, the prisoner, stops him. Now the guard knows he's nuts, right? And the guard wonders, you know, what is it about these guys? And it doesn't take much for Paul to lead this guard and his whole family to the Lord. Paul knows how to dance even in pain. He can say unashamedly, practice what you see in me. I enjoy life, and you can too. I have joy even now in prison. You can choose joy also. Now, Tim Hansel tells about a friend of his who once got his words mixed up when he said, all we have is the past, the present, and the future. And Hansel says, we thought that was an even better way to say a truth that all too many of us miss. You know, few Christians recognize how radical their posture in the world truly is. Their past is absolutely forgiven, and their future is absolutely certain. So that more than any other body of people on earth, they're free to live in the present tense. So I have a question for you. Content or discontent? Which tent do you live in? Have you learned the secret of contentment? Part of the secret of living in the right tent is to see that even in the midst of problems, we can be content. Part of the secret is knowing that this is possible, that it is a choice. It means that we can let go of what we think ought to be and then let God work through what actually is. It means that we can say, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Stephen Levine wrote that much thought has at its root a dissatisfaction with what is. Wanting is the urge for the next moment to contain what this moment does not. When there's wanting in the mind, that moment feels incomplete. Wanting is seeking elsewhere. Completeness is being right here. We don't have to look somewhere else. We can trust our shepherd right where we are. And the more we fight God's leading, especially if we're in pain resisting God's leading, then the more amplified that pain becomes. Can we bring ourselves to the point where we can honestly say, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. There's a wonderful story about a Sunday school teacher who stood up in front of a whole group of kids, you know, and she asked if any of them could recite from memory the 23rd Psalm. And he was surprised that the youngest girl there, 4 years old, raised her hand, you know. And so he asked her again if she has memorized the whole chapter. And she said, absolutely, yes, I can do it. So the teacher asked her to stand up and recite the 23rd Psalm. So she gets in front of this whole crowd. She bravely faces all these other children and she said, the Lord is my shepherd. That's all I want. She said, that's a great summary of Psalm 23. And that's the secret to being content and living in the pleasant moment. The Lord is my shepherd. That's all I want. Because we can do all things through Him who strengthens us. Amen.